Thanks very much for the introduction. So let me start at the beginning. Okay, Luca's introduction already covered a good part of my first slide. I just want to mention that when I wrote the object tracking framework for our self-driving cars projects, I realized that the classical way to write linear algebra code is just not expressive and type-safe enough, in my opinion. This is why I wrote the type-safe matrix, which is going to be the topic of today's talk. But first of all, a little advertisement. We at Bosch, we are hiring. So in case you're interested in automated driving, self-driving vehicles, or driver assistance, please check out the job listings under the link here. We'd really love to hear from you. But now onto the actual talk. The title of my talk is Physical Units for Matrices. How hard can it be? And as it turns out, it can be pretty hard. So hard, in fact, that the math professor George Hart wrote a book on the topic in the 90s called Multidimensional Analysis. And unfortunately, I only found out that the book existed after I was almost finished with my work. So on one hand, this is a pity because it could have saved me a lot of work. But on the other hand, I'm also pretty sure that I wouldn't have come up with the same kind of solution that I did now if I had read the book before. So first of all, I want to start with a little bit of background of C++ programming in the automotive industry and at my employer at Bosch. As you might know, in the automotive industry, there are lots of development processes which also include lots of code reviews. And this means that the code should ideally be written for the reader. This can be achieved by using C++ types that express the content of each variable. Furthermore, it's good to try to leverage C++'s type system to catch problems as early as possible. And as early as possible means at compile time. To achieve this, we have our in-house physical units library for scalars in use for over 15 years now. Similarly, we have an in-house linear algebra library for vector and matrix arithmetics. But what has been missing until recently is a general solution for physical units in linear algebra types. So there was no good way to combine physical units with linear algebra types. And a similar argument can also be made for C++ open source libraries and recent proposals for the standard library. For linear algebra, you might know there's Eigen, there's Blaze and P1385. For physical units, there's P1935, Boost Units, and a few other libraries. I think we also have a few of the maintainers of the libraries in the talk today. I'm really looking forward to your questions afterwards. And as we can see here, this is a ticket from the physical units library. And also for that library, there's the question how physical units can be used in vector types. I should mention that the ticket is closed here because there's a simple solution in one case. So if we have a uniform vector where each entry has the same physical unit, then we can simply use the value type of that vector to specify the physical unit. And if this is done, then the addition of two vectors with unit meters is possible, but adding meters to seconds is not possible. But again, for the general case of non-uniform units, there is a solution that's missing for physical units in linear algebra types. So also for the physical units and linear algebra libraries here, there's no way for non-uniform vectors. And if this has not been enough of a motivation, there is also P1417, a paper called Historical Lessons for C++ Linear Algebra Library Standardization. I'll just read a quote from that paper. Linear algebra libraries all must figure out what to do if users attempt to perform operations on objects with incompatible dimensions. This gets more complicated, though, if we generalize compatible dimensions to the mathematical idea of a vector space. Two vectors might have the same dimensions, but it still might not make sense to add them together. For example, I can't add a coordinate in 3D Euclidean space to a quadratic polynomial with real coefficients, just like I can't add meters to seconds. So let's keep this argument in mind for the rest of the talk and see if we can solve that vector space problem. Furthermore, there's also a second quote from that paper. I don't want to read it here. This deals with order variables. So if you use order variables to capture the return type of a linear algebra operation, then you can get dangling references if one of the operands of the operation is a temporary. I also found a solution for this. If time permits, I can talk about that too. Good, now I want to explain how I started the activities on the topic. So when doing code reviews or when reading other people's code, you often see code like this in linear algebra code. So I should mention these are linear algebra vectors and not std vectors, so don't confuse the two. So here we have an access to other vector at position 3, and we assign it to measurement vector at position 2. And when I see code like this, I immediately have two questions. The first question is, what do the vector entries actually describe? Because from this line, there's no indication whatsoever what's at position 3 or at position 2 in these vectors. If you're lucky, there's a comment around or the variables are described where they're declared. Furthermore, this could also be an out-of-bounds access. This can, of course, be caught by a static analysis tool or by firing an assertion at runtime or an exception. But ideally, I don't want to have to think about whether this could be an out-of-bounds access. I would like to have a guarantee that it cannot be one. Then the second try for a similar code line might look like this here. So now we access other vector at position x index and assign it to measurement vector at velocity x index. And when I see that, again, I have two questions. The first one is, have the right index constants for the vector type been used? Because we don't have a guarantee that these index types or constants, whatever it is, might be enumerator constants, are actually intended for these vectors. And the second question, where your physics teacher comes into play, is whether assigning a position to a velocity is really intended. So most likely, this here is a bug or a very questionable operation. In the third try, maybe the code looks like this here. So we have an other vector assign, we access velocity x index and assign it to measurement vector also at velocity x index. Now this code looks a lot better. It's probably valid, but there's still one question remaining. And the question is, in which coordinate frame are measurement vector and other vector? Because if they are from two different coordinate frames, then again, this might be an invalid operation or a bug. Good, from the examples before, I came up with my linear algebra wish list of how I would like to have a linear algebra library for me. So first of all, I would like to have a protection against out-of-bounds access at compile time, please, so not at runtime, because this is too late. Second, I would like to have expressive and enforced names for all vector and matrix entries. And when I implemented that, I realized that actually much more can be done with this approach. Because if we have expressive and enforced names for the vector and matrix entries, then it's also possible to support non-uniform physical units in vectors and matrices. Furthermore, we can also achieve a compatibility check for physical units during all matrix operations, again, at compile time. And last but not least, it's possible to achieve coordinate frame annotations for all vectors and also for transformations between different vector spaces. Now I want to move on to the first ingredient of the secret sauce. This is named index structs. And these index structs identify each entry in a vector with a unique name. In this case here, the DXC stands for distance x, and the C at the end indicates that this is a Cartesian index. Now, when we declare such a struct, this is done by deriving from Cartesian index type a base class, and the first template argument of the class is a coordinate frame, in this case, the vehicle front axle coordinate frame. The second argument specifies which axis this index refers to. This is the Cartesian x-axis, and the third argument says that this index has the physical unit meter. Down at the bottom, you can also see how the coordinate frames defined. This is also an almost empty struct. We derive from a base class, specify the unit, and we have to define whether this frame is moving with respect to the fixed earth frame. So we assume that the earth frame is fixed and not moving, which is an approximation, of course. As a second example, we can also define another index. This is the dy, distance y index in sensor coordinates. And again, we specify the matching template arguments, sensor coordinates frame, and the Cartesian y-axis. As a general rule, we construct the indices as shown here on the right-hand side. So first of all, I picked the physical quantity, distance, velocity, acceleration. This gives the first part of the name. So I just use the D, V, or A. Second part of the name is the axis, X, Y, Z axis. And the third part is the coordinate frame, in this case here, the sensor frame. Now I should also mention why the DXC index here does not mention the coordinate frame. This is because in our application, in self-driving vehicles, the host vehicle front axle frame is sort of the standard frame. And this is the frame that you use quite often, and you have to type these types fairly often. So it makes sense to have a short name for that. This is why I chose to leave out the mention of the coordinate frame whenever we're in vehicle front axle coordinates. Of course, all of these index types are completely configurable by the user. So if you have a new project, you can pick your own names, whatever you like, make them expressive or just short and use three-letter acronyms. That's up to you. Good. After that, we can move on to the first class, which is the class TypeSafe Matrix. This is actually the most important class in the library because it is used to represent all vectors and matrices. This class has four template arguments. The first one is the scalar type. The second one is a type list that specifies the row indices of the matrix. The third one specifies the column indices of the matrix. And the last one is the matrix tag. The matrix tag here is also pretty important because this is used to distinguish the different types of matrices. For example, we have covariance matrices, Jacobian matrices, we have column vectors, row vectors, information matrices, and a few more. I will show a table later of all the options. And now the only data member of the class is a matrix of an underlying linear algebra library. This can be Eigen, Blaze, or any library. In this example, I picked Eigen. And the Eigen matrix takes the scalar type that we passed to TypeSafe matrix, we use as dimension the size of the row index list and the size of the column index list. Now there's also an alias for a TypeSafe vector. This is simply a TypeSafe matrix with the given scalar type, row indices, and matrix tag. And the column indices here is a type list with just one element, sort of an empty type, the noindex type. And this is a type that has no influence on the physical unit of the vector. And now we can use this to define our first concrete vector. This is a position vector of dimension 3 in vehicle frame. We use the TypeSafe vector alias instantiated with a given scalar type. And the type list here consists of dx, dy, dz, so x, y, and z position in vehicle frame. The tag here at the end is a vector tag. This describes a point in the mathematical sense. So my library distinguishes between points and displacement vectors. A displacement vector would get a delta vector tag here. So this is a point in the mathematical sense. Now I want to explain how we can create a vector and access its elements. This here creates a position vector 3 in vehicle frame. And for the constructor, we list the individual argument, the individual elements of the vector. I show three options here, and they are ordered by decreasing level of type safety. So the first version here is the most type safe, the 3-star version, where we access an entry from another vector, other position here, and this is then used to initialize the x position in that vector. This does the most checks. So first of all, there's a check that the x position is actually part of other position vector. There's a check that the other position vector has the exact same type as the vector we're constructing, and only then it is assigned. The second most type-safe version is to use the method rep coefficient SI. Again, you specify the index, dy in this case, and you pass it a physical unit. So in this case, the only check that's done is the physical unit check, which is also quite good. And the last, the third option, which should be avoided if possible, rep coefficient. This method simply takes a scalar argument. This means there's no check at all. Only the scalar type has to match. The physical unit is ignored in this case. So we simply initialize a physical quantity with a 3 here, so physical quantity of meter. Now the same thing can also be done after construction if we want to access elements from a vector. Again, this is ordered by the level of type safety. We can read, as I showed before, from a vector by calling the ng method and specifying the index. We can write by calling assign entry, and again, there's a full check that the two vectors have the same type, that the index exists in both vectors. Yeah, and this is all checked. Second most type-safe version, this is sort of the equivalent of the rep coefficient SI method, is to use coefficient SI for reading and coefficient SI ref for writing. In this case, only the unit is checked, so it's possible here to assign the Y position from the vehicle frame to the X position in sensor frame. This would be possible in this case and not forbidden. And the last version, the least type safe again, is to use the add method specifying the index and also writing with the add method. Here we can even mix up physical units. So as you see here, I access the Y velocity in sensor frame and assign it to X position in sensor frame, which is most likely incorrect, but still the method allows it. Okay, there are also more ways how we can create a vector and matrix. This is a little bit more complex example. Here we have a delta position vector of dimension 3, so a displacement vector. And this is initialized by multiplying a duration here in seconds with another velocity vector of dimension 2. Multiplying a velocity vector with a duration gives us a displacement vector, so we get the same type, and it has the size 2, so this is used to initialize the first two elements of the three-dimensional vector. The last element is again initialized by calling the ng method. The same thing is, of course, also possible for matrices. In this example here, we're constructing a covariance matrix. This has the covariance matrix tag here. Indices are x position and x velocity in vehicle frame. And then the individual elements of the matrix are listed by calling rep coefficient SI, and you have to specify now, of course, as we're in a matrix, we have to specify the row and the column index. There are more options. Of course, you can also construct the matrix column-wise, construct the matrix row-wise, you can construct it from several blocks or from rows and smaller blocks. All of that is possible. And I should also mention that in my library, in contrast to what Eigen or Blaze would do, all of the column types or row types have a different type because they describe a different index. And this means that I'm also able to do checks that the order is correct. So for example, if four columns are passed as here, then I can do a check that actually the columns are in the correct order. Furthermore, it might seem to you, I don't see your faces, so maybe you're wondering why the syntax here is a little bit verbose, because you have to always mention the indices. This was a deliberate design choice on my behalf, and it also enables a few nice features. For example, the library can always check if the order of elements is correct, and can also alert the user which entry is incorrect if the order has been mixed up. Furthermore, this even allows to exchange, so completely exchange, the order of the indices in a vector or a matrix. I actually did that in our Kalman filtering code, where you have state estimates of dimension 8, 10, or 12. So I exchanged the order of the indices, and afterwards you get a lot of static assertions by my library, and you have to fix them, of course. And once I was finished and the last compiler error was fixed, the library worked again. So there were no bugs left over, which is really nice, I think. So you don't have to care if you reorder indices, because all of the methods in the library, when you access rows and columns, that's always used with the index type. You never use an integer, so there's not much potential for error there. Good. So now I continue to matrix element access. This slide here shows how we can declare a type-safe Jacobian matrix on the left-hand side. The image on the right-hand side also visualizes the Jacobian. The different indices here are MeshDR. This is a radial distance measurement. This could be, for example, from a radar sensor, where we have the radial distance measurement, we have the radial velocity measurement with units meter per second, and we have the measurement angle in radians. The columns of the matrix are X, Y, and Z position with unit meters in vehicle frame. And now we're getting to the first question. Lucas might already have posted a link in the chat. So the question is, which physical unit should be returned for this access here? So we access with the coefficient SI method the element at index mesh VR. So row is mesh VR with unit meters per second, and the column is dy with unit meter. Now the question is, which physical unit should be returned when I access this element here in the red box? So I quickly see if I okay, here's the chat. So these are the four options. So we either have 1 divided by second as an option, we have meter, we have second, or we have meter squared divided by second as an option. And I already see only 5 people have dared to answer, and they all picked the correct answer, 1 divided by second. This is really nice. The reason for this is we have a Jacobian matrix. So if you don't know this, a Jacobian describes the derivative, in this case of the row index, with respect to the column index. So we take the derivative of meters per second with respect to meter, and derivatives give a unit which can be calculated by dividing the two by each other. I will show that down here. So this is a general rule for all matrices. So first of all, we have to introduce the notion of row exponent and column exponent. The row exponent is 1 for a Jacobian matrix, and the column exponent is -1. And then the general rule that works for all kinds of matrices is this one here. So we first take the unit of the row, meters per second, we raise it to the power of the row exponent, which is 1 in this case, and then we multiply it with the column unit, meters, raised to the power of the column exponent, -1. So in the end, we end up with a division of meters per second divided by meter, so 1/2 second is the result. Good. Now, as I promised, this is the full taxonomy of all vector and matrix types. Here, for example, we've already seen that there are covariance matrices with row and column exponent 1. So the units are multiplied for the element access. In a Jacobian, we have row exponent 1, column exponent -1. There's also information matrices, which are the inverse of a covariance matrices. There are position vectors, displacement vectors, and information vectors. And what's also there are vector collections. So vector collections is a matrix that consists of individual vectors in the columns or rows of the matrix. And of course, we don't only have these types here, like position vectors. We can also have the transposed version of these. So I didn't list them here. I think it should be obvious what the row and column exponents look like in this case. So until now, we have seen how we can get unit-safe element access and out-of-bounds protections when we access elements. But the big question now is, can we do even more? And as it turns out, there's a lot more we can do. But before that, I would like to take this slide for a brief intermission and see if we have questions. I think Lucas wanted to help me out here.
Okay, so Lucas, the connection is stalled, so I'll take this. So far, there's no questions in the chat.
Okay.
So I think we can just continue.
Yeah.
Oh, there's one. Sorry. Ah. There's one.
Dynamic matrices, I see it. Yeah, that's actually a really good question. Excellent question. So far, I only implemented it for matrices of constant size, so where the size is known at compile time. But it would be possible to extend that to dynamic matrices if the dynamic part, like if the columns are dynamic, then each of the elements has to have the same units. This is usually the case, I think. Mm-hmm. And then you could, again, allow an integer to access the elements. Of course, the out-of-bounds protection would then maybe not work, at least not at compile time. Mm-hmm. But it's no problem to implement that. The syntax might look a little bit weird, maybe, if you mix up the indices with an integer, but yeah, can be implemented and should be straightforward. So far, when we needed that, we usually used a vector type for that, like a std vector in this case, and put linear algebra vectors in there, which sort of serves a similar purpose. Not perfect, but was okay for now.
All right. So that's it for now. Thank you.
Good. Then I'll just continue with the second half of my talk. Seems that everybody understood everything and it was so easy that I have to speed up a bit. Let's see. So now we again have a few questions on that slide. So please answer in the poll. So we're trying to be unit safe for all operations now. The first of all, this is not for the poll. This question is fairly easy, so I'll do that without the poll. So here we have an operation where we add two vectors. So we have an xy position vector with unit meters. And to that vector, we are adding an xy velocity vector with unit meter per second. Should this operation be allowed? And I'm pretty sure that most of you would know the answer here. That's fairly easy because we're actually mixing physical units. So this is an invalid operation because we shouldn't add meters to meters per second. Next example is a little bit more involved. So now we have these two vectors. We have two vectors that have unit meters in all of their entries. Should this operation be allowed and be a valid operation or not? I'll move over to the chat and see if we have any answers. It might take a few seconds until they show up. So the question again was, should this addition be allowed where we have two vectors and all of the entries in both vectors have physical unit meter? So I see the first answers come in, six saying yes. No one dares to say no. All right, all the answers, nine yes, zero for no. And of course, the answer is a little bit more difficult. Ah, I saw just one no coming in. Actually, both are sort of correct because it depends. This is a trick question, of course, because what if these two vectors actually describe x and y position vector and y and z position vector in vehicle frame? Then in this case, the index types do not match up and the addition should not be allowed because these are different types. So they are from a different vector space. They are from the same coordinate frame, but they're actually from a different vector space. And this is the vector space argument that we had in the beginning. this operation should not be allowed. This leads me to the conclusion that we should take home from this slide. Unit safety, physical unit safety, is not enough. We need index type safety. And this index type safety is actually a much stronger condition than just unit type safety. And currently, with classical linear algebra libraries, misusages like this would have to be caught with code reviews. This is, of course, doable, but it takes up a lot of manual effort, and it would be much nicer if the library could take care of that and alert the user. Good. So now let's move on to a bigger example of a matrix operation. So in this case, we are multiplying three matrices that are shown down here. Up here is the code line, and these are the matrices down here. So for now, ignore the numbers in here. These are just examples. What is important are the indices in the matrix. So in the middle, we have a covariance matrix in vehicle frame with indices x position, y position, x velocity, and y velocity. Now, when the multiplication is done in the library, here on the right-hand side, this is the Jacobian transpose. The first thing that is checked is that the indices in the orange boxes here are actually identical. If this is the case, then we also check that the row and column exponents here in red are the sine inverse of each other. And if this is the case, then the indices in the orange boxes disappear, and the column indices from the Jacobian transpose here on the right-hand side are moved over to the covariance in the middle, as you will see now. And now, the same thing is done on the left-hand side. We again check that the indices match up, that the exponents are the sine inverse of each other, and if this is the case, the indices in the orange box cancel out. Then the row indices, and this time the row indices of the Jacobian here, are moved over to the covariance in the middle. And now this already concludes the operation, and we can see that we now have a covariance in center frame. I left out the center here because the space was a little bit tight. And we can also see that this is exactly what we assign it to. So on the left-hand side here, we have a covariance in center frame. This means that the whole operation is valid and is checked as valid by the library. If any of the indices or the arguments would be different, for example, if the user accidentally puts the transposed Jacobian on the left-hand side, this would lead to a static assertion. Now I want to explain a little bit about the design of the library and show some building blocks. The first block that we've already seen is our class TypeSafe matrix down here. This class inherits from class matrix base with a CRTP pattern. So this means the template argument of the base class is the derived class, the TypeSafe matrix here. We can see this down here. Now, the third part, the third building block that we still need is a matrix expression. This matrix expression class has two template arguments. The first template argument is a promotion type, and this promotion type is responsible for promoting the two input type safe matrices of the operation, if it's a binary operation, to the resulting output type safe matrix. This means the promotion is responsible for inferring the four template arguments of the resulting type safe matrix, so scalar, rows, columns, and the matrix tag. The second part of the matrix expression that we also need is a linear algebra expression from, in this case, Eigen. And this linear algebra library is responsible for doing the calculations at runtime. So the promotion is responsible for checking preconditions at compile time and verifying that everything is okay. And the linear algebra expression is responsible for doing calculations at runtime. Now I want to show what one of the operations in the matrix class looks like. This here is the addition operator that accepts anything that's derived from matrix base as an argument. The return type of the operator plus is the matrix expression class that we've seen before, where the first template argument is a promotion to the addition type. This is responsible for promoting the types of the addition. And the linear algebra library type from Eigen is really simple. This is just a decal type of the underlying types of the two arguments. So this can be an Eigen vector matrix or also a matrix or vector expression from Eigen. Now I want to explain how these promotions are constructed. The promotions are empty structs that only derive from a few base classes. In this case, the first base class is called requires identical scalar type, and it does exactly what it says in the name. So it checks that the scalar type of the two arguments, the input arguments, are identical. Furthermore, it also injects a scalar alias, the scalar type alias that is used later to infer the resulting type-safe matrix. Then we have two more base classes that require identical row indices and identical column indices. And again, these two base classes also inject row index list and column index list aliases in for the resulting type. Then we require identical row unit exponents and column unit exponents of the two arguments. And the last one, the last requirement, is that the matrix tags are addition compatible. What this means is that, for example, you cannot add two points in the mathematical sense, but you can add a point to a displacement vector or two displacement vectors. And this is checked by this requirement, and it also injects the resulting matrix tag type. And last but not least, we'll have a look at the requires identical row indices, so one of these base classes. This is also, again, almost an empty struct. The only content is a static assertion that checks that the two row index lists are identical. And as I said, it injects the alias, the row index list of the resulting type. The type identity checker here, if, in case you wonder, that's sort of a replacement for statisame that produces a little bit nicer error messages where you can actually see the two types. This is also what I want to show on the next slide, because if you've worked with template heavy libraries, you might know that template error messages are notoriously difficult to read. So this is why I tried, I implemented everything exactly in this way with the base classes, because this is able to produce fairly nice template error messages, as we will see on the next slide. So we'll take a look at this operation here, which adds a three-dimensional position vector to a two-dimensional position vector in the same frame. Now the error message looks like this. First of all, we get a static assertion from the type identity checker that we've seen before. This is because two types are mismatching, and then we'll have a look at the instantiation history to see where it actually comes from. This static assert comes from the promotion to the addition that we've seen before. And this has a base class, requires identical row indices. And that base class then in turn instantiates the type identity checker. And then we can see here that the type identity checker is called with two different type lists. The first type list has three elements, second type list, two elements. So similar error messages would, of course, also be produced if you had two-dimensional vectors where one has x and y position and the other one y and z position. Because this three-dimensional and two-dimensional example, of course, would also be caught by any other linear algebra library. Maybe it would have been better to pick x and y and z position here as an example. Now, these error messages here and the requirements might remind you of something. I should mention my library is designed for C++ 11, so no concepts in C++ 11. So this is sort of the replacement or the re-implementation of concepts in C++ 11. Of course, this could also be done with C++ 20 concepts. I don't want to go into details here, but this is what the error message would look like if we would convert what I showed before to a concept addable that checks whether two vectors or matrices are actually addable. We get also a nice error messages and see that two type lists here have a different size. The only difference between concepts and what I did is that I can at the same time inject these aliases into the derived class that we've seen. This would be not possible out of the box with concepts. I don't know, maybe there's a way to do that with concepts, but it would probably be some additional work and not work out of the box. Good. Now I'll quickly check if we have any urgent questions. Okay. The question was already about concepts. Yeah, I think I answered that already. So now I continue with that slide, which actually transports us back to the very beginning of my talk. At the beginning of my talk, I showed this code example here that proved that we can use a vector and use a physical unit as the value type in that vector. With that, we can represent uniform vectors and matrices. Now, the image here on the right-hand side is taken from the book that I showed in the beginning by George W. Hart. And this visualizes the different classes of physical units-aware matrices. So what we can model with that unit as value type approach are only the uniform matrices, which are the gray array here with the orange border. But we can also see that the whole problem space is actually much larger. And what I aim at with my index-oriented design in type-safe matrix is to represent the blue oval here of multipliable matrices, which is almost the full problem space. So we can see that I aim at a much larger problem. And we can also see that I will show later that the gray area here, if we do some operations in that gray area, that the modeling with a unit as a value type is not detailed enough. To see this, I will explain now what can be added and multiplied. So which vectors and which matrices can be added and or multiplied. So on this slide, I have the what I call unit as value type approach. So this is one physical unit as a value type in a vector on the left-hand side, and on the right-hand side, my type-safe matrix. So the table here shows the addition of two vectors A and B, and we have different options for A and B. The first option is a position vector with X and Y position in vehicle frame. Second option is Y and Z position in that frame. Third option is a displacement vector, delta vector, with X and Y indices also in vehicle frame. And the fourth option is an XY velocity vector also in vehicle frame. Now with the unit as value type approach, the only operation that is being prevented is when we mix up different physical units. So if we add any of the position vectors or displacement vectors to the velocity vector. For all other operations, there's no way how this approach could forbid the operations, because the annotation is simply not available. So with this approach, there's no way to distinguish between X, Y position or Y and Z position. With type-safe matrix, on the other hand, this looks a little bit different. So here we can see that most of the table actually turns to gray and the operations are not allowed. For example, we cannot add two points or two position vectors, even if they have the same indices and are in the same frame. We also cannot add two vectors if they have different indices, of course, but what can be added is a position vector with X and Y position and a displacement vector with X and Y indices. Furthermore, two displacement or delta vectors can also be added, of course. And as we see on the bottom right, two velocity vectors, this is also possible. So we can already see quite a difference here in the how detailed the modeling is. Now I want to show the same thing for the multiplication of two matrices A and B. Again, we have different options for A and B. The first option is a Jacobian matrix. We can have a Jacobian transpose, a covariance, or a vector. And as we can see, everything's green here, so all of these multiplications are valid, of course, given that the dimensions of the matrices match up. Then all of the operations here are valid if we only have a unit as value type annotation. Because again, there's no distinction between Jacobian, Jacobian transpose, and covariance with that approach. It's not annotated at all. With type-safe matrix, on the other hand, again, similar picture as before. Most of the table turns to gray and the operations are not allowed. What is allowed or might be allowed is when we multiply two Jacobian matrices. Then, as we've seen before in the multiplication example, the multiplication is allowed if the inner indices of the two matrices match up. If the indices do not match up, then again, this would be invalid and the operation would be prohibited. Same thing holds for a Jacobian that is multiplied with a covariance. This is, can also be valid if the indices match up, and multiplying a Jacobian with a vector is also possible. Furthermore, two transposed Jacobians can be multiplied, and a covariance with a Jacobian transposed on the right-hand side. So I hope this was clear from the slide. So the major difference between the two approaches here is, first of all, the type-safe matrix is able to model a much larger problem space. And as we can see here, it's also modeled much more accurately. So type-safe matrix aims to model it in the mathematical accurate way, while the other approach simply cannot model it that detailed because the annotations are not available. Now I want to move on to a little bit a different topic, which are transformations and rotation matrices. So this example here shows how we can define an isometry. In case you don't know this, an isometry is a transformation that consists of a rotation and a translation. And the class isometry has, again, four template arguments. The first one is the scalar type of the content. We have the destination frame first, then second, the source frame. And please note how also source and destination frame are on the left-hand side in the variable name. And so destination frame is on the left-hand side and source frame is on the right-hand side. And the dimension is the last template argument. So 3 is the dimension of the isometry, meaning this is a transformation between two three-dimensional spaces. Now, when we have this annotation and this class, this enables an automatic compile time checks for the correctness of transformation order. And again, later after that, we will get in a question, so please post in the chat. So first of all, I want to explain here, this transforms a position vector in odometry frame with a transform from odometry frame to vehicle frame and assigns it to a position vector in vehicle frame. And just as I did the coloring here and also the variable names and the transformation names, this is exactly what the library does internally. So it checks that the vector here on the right-hand side is in the source frame, the vector on the left-hand side is in the destination frame. If any of this would not be true, again, the user would get a static assertion and be alerted of the problem. Now, moving on to my next question. Is this operation here valid or not? Please answer in the chat if you know the answer. So we're transforming a velocity vector this time, again, in the odometry frame, and we apply the full isometry consisting of rotation and translation to that vector to get to a velocity vector in vehicle frame. Should this operation be valid or not? So let's see. Okay, so we have one yes, one no. That might lead to a draw. We have two yes, two no, three yes, two no. I think I confused you enough with the earlier questions. Okay, so five yes, two no by now. So I move over to the slide and explain what the answer is. So as I explained earlier, we apply a rotation and a translation to a velocity vector. And a velocity vector has a fixed length and we rotate that to get to another frame. But now the question is, should we also translate the vector, which would mean shrinking or enlarging the velocity vector? So if the two coordinate frames are not moving with respect to each other or are fixed with respect to the Earth, then the velocity certainly shouldn't change its length if we move to a different frame. So this means, again, this operation is invalid and the velocity should not be translated. This leads to a compiler error. What should be allowed, on the other hand, is when we take the linear part of the transformation, so only the rotational part, and we apply this to the velocity vector. This only transforms the vector. And I should also mention that this transformation is only possible for Earth-fixed frames. This is why we needed the annotation in the beginning that I showed. If two frames are moving relative to each other, then the calculations are much more complex. You get these Coriolis velocities, I think is the name. So you need a much more complicated calculation and cannot do it with a simple application of the isometry. The same is also true if we have a displacement vector. So if a displacement vector is transformed to a different frame, then again, we should not change its length because the displacement keeps its length when we go to a different coordinate frame. So we again have to apply the linear part here. So until now, we mainly used 2D and 3D Cartesian position and velocity vectors in different coordinate frames. The type-safe matrix is not at all restricted to this use case. It's also possible to represent other quantities. For example, if you have a line fit, the slope and offset of a line fit, and you want to put that in a vector because it's more convenient, then you could define two structs, so two index types here, slope and offset, derived from non-Cartesian index type. And in this case, you only have to specify the physical units because a non-Cartesian index type is not annotated with a coordinate frame. And then the major difference between these Cartesian vectors that I showed before and non-Cartesian vectors or the indices is that transformations are only possible for Cartesian vectors because only for them we have the annotation of the coordinate frame. Furthermore, things like calculating the norm, the cross product or the dot product is also only possible for Cartesian vectors because only these form a proper vector space. Now I want to move on to object tracking, which is my field of application. In this example, we'll talk about Kalman filtering of dynamic objects. In object tracking, we have different state estimates, for example, a constant acceleration, CA state estimate, that contains three position indices, two velocity indices, two acceleration indices, and an orientation. Further ingredients for Kalman filtering are the measurements. These are the ones that we've seen before, and covariance and Jacobian matrices. Here I will explain the different matrices. This is the H matrix, which is a Jacobian in the Kalman filter, the measurement matrix. And this transforms from the state space, so the estimated state of the checked object, and transforms to the measurement space. We also have the inverse matrix, sort of, the K matrix, which transforms from measurement space to state space. There's also a measurement covariance matrix, R, and of course the state vector in state space and the state covariance also in state space. Now again, I want to explain how these Kalman filter equations here, especially the one for the K matrix, how the operations here propagate through my library. So we start with the innermost term, which is the covariance with state indices shown in green here. Then this is multiplied from the left-hand side with the H matrix and from the right-hand side with the transposed H matrix. Now we can see that the state indices here are actually cancel out in the middle. So we have quite often the state index here on the left-hand, on the right-hand side. And again, as we've seen in the matrix multiplication example before, all these state indices cancel out and we end up with a covariance matrix in measurement space. Then this covariance matrix in measurement space is added to another covariance matrix in measurement space, the R matrix. We take the inverse, And then with the inverse, we get an information matrix in measurement space. Then we multiply this with the H matrix transpose from the left-hand side. Again, the measurement indices in the middle cancel out, and we end up with a green part here, which is an information matrix with states in state space as rows and measurement space as columns. Then in the last operation, this is multiplied with a covariance in state space. Again, the inner indices cancel out, and we end up in red here with a Jacobian matrix with state rows and measurement columns. And this is exactly the K matrix up here. And this is also what the matrix gets assigned to here. So this means, again, we have checked the full set of complex operations here with type-safe matrix, and this is a valid operation. Again, if any of the operands would be different, this would most likely fire a static assertion, and the user is alerted of that. Good, now I move on to my last two slides. This is sort of object checking in a nutshell in two slides. So this slide explains how state vectors in our application can be used for tracking. So in the table, the different columns show the state estimates, and the rows show the different indices that can either be part of the state estimate if they contain an X, or are not part of the state estimate if the box is empty. The C equals zero here indicates that this value is constrained to zero. And now if we look at the table, the states shown in the table represent the velocities in different ways. This is shown in the orange box. So there are three different ways how the velocities can be represented. The first two blue rows are the first representation, which is a Cartesian 2D representation in vehicle frame. So there we use Vx and Vy as a representation. The second option is to use V longitudinal and V lateral, which is in this case the velocity along the longitudinal object, along the longitudinal axis of the tracked object, and along the lateral axis, which is perpendicular to that. Usually the lateral velocity is constrained to zero unless the objects are drifting. And the third representation of the velocities is when we use speed and heading. So speed is the absolute magnitude of the velocity, and heading is the heading direction of the object that is being checked. Now, as an example here of the different velocity representations in the constant position state estimate, this is our first column here. We don't estimate the velocities, so they're constrained to zero in this case. For the constant velocity state, the CV state, we use Vx and Vy and estimate them, and they are also part of the state estimate. As a third example, in the CT, constant turn rate state estimate, we use V longitudinal and V lateral to represent the velocities. Now, the challenge with this, because we have so many state estimates, is that each state should now provide accessors for each of the different representations. So this means in this example for here that the constant velocity CV state estimate should provide accessors for each of the indices in the red box here. So it should provide Vx and Vy. It should be able to output V longitudinal and V lateral, and it should also be able to output speed and heading. So in classical OOP, this would of course call for a large class hierarchy where you have to implement lots of accessors for each of the different state indices. With the index-oriented design in type-safe matrix, however, we can take a completely different approach, because we have a compile time annotation of the content of all of the state vectors. So in this case, we can use template magic instead. Here, we'll take a look on the next slide at how the speed index can be queried in this in a few state estimates. So here, again, this is the code example from the beginning. We want to, from the last slide, we want to query the state index here. We want to query the speed index from the given state. And now, as a first example, if we want to query that for the constant position state estimate here, we want to query the red box here. And this is implemented then in terms of an index source helper template that is shown here on the left-hand side. That index source template specifies that the speed index in the CP state estimate here, so the red box, can be calculated or should be calculated with a constraint zero policy, as the velocities are constrained to zero here. And now if we move on to the next state estimate, the constant velocity state estimate, there the policy specifies that we should compute the velocities from the Cartesian representation, meaning from Vx and Vy. Third example in the constant turn rate state estimate, there the policy specifies that we should compute the velocities from the object local representation, meaning from V longitudinal and V lateral. And the last and also simplest example for the full polar state estimate, which is the last column here, the speed index is actually contained in the state estimate. So the policy is fairly simple here. That's the contained in state policy, and we simply have to return the index that's already part of the state estimate. Actually, in this case, it isn't even necessary to specify that manually. This could, of course, be inferred by a little bit template matching at compile time, because we already know the indices in the vector. They're annotated in the type list of the vector. Now, in addition to this example, what I showed here, there are a few more things when you have Kalman filtering and so many state estimates where the type-safe matrix, the index-oriented design, comes in handy. For example, you have to be able to convert between the different state estimates and state representations. If you have 8 to 10 different state estimates, then you have actually the cross product of the number of the two states, of the different states, so 64 to 100 different conversion functions that have to be implemented. And if all of this would have to be done manually, this would mean lots of repeated code. But with the approach that I've shown here, it's also possible to implement these state conversions in a generic way. So in a certain way, we are doing a code generation at compile time with a compiler in this case. And as a last example, it would also be possible to represent the sparse Jacobians in a different way, because in this application, a lot of the Jacobians are actually sparse, so a lot of the entries in Jacobians are zero. And if this is the case, we know that at compile time, because we can represent the derivatives in the Jacobian with the indices, and then we know which derivative is going to be zero. And this can also be used, we're not there yet, but it might be used at some point to optimize the multiplication operations if you multiply a Jacobian with another vector. Because in this case, you only have to access the non-zero elements, and this can lead to much faster code. Good, this almost is the end of my talk. I only have 2 slides left for the operations. I don't want to explain all the operations. Maybe the first 2 ones are pretty interesting. Unchecked const matrix and unchecked mutable matrix. This allows the access to the underlying eigen or blaze or whatever library you use matrix, which can be useful, for example, if one operation has not been implemented in type-safe matrix. Of course, you're on your own. All type-safe checks are switched off by this, and you're back to your original linear algebra library. Furthermore, I also want to mention that all of the methods here mention the indices explicitly, so all of the integer indices are gone in this case. Second slide also lists a few operations. These are the classical ones. And of course, anything that you want, if it's available in your linear algebra library that's underneath, then it should also be possible to implement it in type-safe matrix. What I implemented here was the few operations that cover 95 to 98% of all of our usages, or even more. And I always add more when I see more usages. So this already leads me to the conclusion. What do we get from type-safe matrix? So first of all, we get expressive and enforced names for vector and matrix entries. We've seen that from the index types. Second, we get a protection against out-of-bounds access at compile time. You always have to specify the index, and if that index is not part of the vector or matrix, you get a static assertion. Third of all, it also enables full support for physical units in vectors and matrices, especially for the non-uniform case. Then there's also a compatibility check for index structs in all matrix operations. As I mentioned, that index struct check is a much stronger condition than just checking for physical units. It's a little bit similar than if you would use physical quantity kinds. And it also includes a notion of coordinate frames, so we can specify a coordinate frame in which a vector lives. We can specify source and destination frame for transformations. There are also other transformations that I didn't show, for example, other affine transforms like scalings or scaling and translation, things like that. And last but not least, this is something that I only discovered when I was finished with the implementation. I have two or three different implementations of my library, one with Eigen underneath, one with Blaze, one with our in-house library. This enables you to actually get an abstraction of the underlying linear algebra library. So if you use TypeSafe Matrix, it's sort of a one-click solution to exchange the underlying linear algebra library in all of your linear algebra code. So I hope you were able to follow me. I want to thank you all for listening, and I'm really looking forward to all of your questions in the chat and maybe also in the after talk in the Zoom meeting. Thank you very much for listening.
Thanks for the talk. It was amazing. There are some questions. Let me start at the top. Is this TypeSafe Matrix library available as open source library?
Yeah, I expected that question. I tried to open source it, and if it were just about my company, I would already have the permission, but it was created in a joint project with another company that's more strict. So I'm still trying to get it open source, but I don't expect that it will be possible. It might be if I'm lucky, but probably not. This is also why I tried to explain how it's implemented. So it's not rocket science if you know the drill, and I'm also not saying that this is the only way to do it. Maybe there are small tweaks here and there where you could do it differently. Yeah, that's probably also possible.
Okay, thanks. The next question is, you mentioned the word compile time many times. So have you measured what's the overhead of all these compile time checks for this library?
Yeah, I did a brief check, and there my estimate was around 20% of what I discovered, but I haven't looked into it in all detail, so maybe it would show up to be a little bit more, or it's probably also possible if you spend effort to reduce the overhead, I would guess. But of course, it does a lot of compile time checks, so a little compile time overhead is expected. Even so, when I remember it from when I use Eigen, most of the compile time overhead, I think, came from the matrix decompositions. These use a lot of memory and also compile time. So if you have that in your code, then adding TypeSafe Matrix might not make a big difference. If you just have simple operations, then I don't know, the 20% or in the ballpark, I guess.
Okay, thanks. Then let's go to the next one. What are the major differences between the solution you implemented and the one described in Hart's book? If you had time, would you redesign your library with the knowledge you have now after reading the book? Kind of two questions.
Yeah. So in the book, I think what I was missing in the beginning when I started on the topic, I didn't realize what the units in a covariance and Jacobian matrix should look like. This took me quite a while to figure it out. And the big difference to the book is that in the book, the author doesn't really, he doesn't talk about covariances and Jacobians. I think he always has row indices and column indices, and he always assumes the column exponent to be -1. So he mainly talks about Jacobian matrices. So it would have been a little bit of transfer from the book getting to what I implemented. So I think my approach is a little bit more tailored to what we need with covariances and Jacobians, but most of the stuff has been explained in the book. So after I solved the problem, the book was really easy to understand for me. If it would have been the other way around, I'm not sure if I would have come to the solution. And about the redesigning question, no, I don't think so. That's actually an implementation contained in the book, I should mention. It's from the 90s. So this is some Pascal-style runtime check. So all of the checks are actually done at runtime. So it costs you runtime overhead. Of course, it was not possible in the 90s, so definitely not the fault of the author. By now, we can do all of that at compile time, and we have almost zero runtime overhead or zero runtime overhead. I probably shouldn't claim zero runtime overhead, otherwise Chandler Carruth will come haunting me, if you remember the talk from CPPCon. So yes, I hope that answered the question.
Yeah, I think that was a great answer. Let's see. You keep mentioning both Eigen and Blaze. Is it possible to switch between the two libraries? If yes, how do you handle the differences, different function names, and in available operations? I'm not sure how to read that.
Yeah, and the available operations probably. So I can switch in our implementation. In our code, I can switch between the two implementations quite easily. Also between our built-in library and Eigen and Blaze. The difference in function names is abstracted away because I'm sort of an extra layer on top. The function names that I picked are a little bit more similar to Eigen because I'm not sure if Klaus should listen in here. For me, I like the Eigen interface a little bit more with the member methods. I know that this is debatable, but from the user perspective, this produced a little bit nicer code in our application, I think, which is why I picked the Eigen syntax. And then underneath, I either forward to the Eigen syntax, which is fairly similar to my syntax, or to Blaze. So in general, I can implement all operations that are available in all of the underlying libraries. But I have to admit, if I look at Eigen and Blaze, I probably covered only 10 or 20% of their operations, I guess. This is sufficient for 99% of everything we need. And yeah, as I said, I keep adding more. We need matrix decompositions, and the rest often is just addition, multiplication of vectors, matrices, and norm, cross product, dot product, stuff like that.
Okay. So maybe as a follow-up question there, what's the reason for being able to use different backends?
The reason, well, in the beginning, we started with Eigen. But as we are in automotive domain, you usually have to get everything certified that should end up in a product. And this means it's better to use our in-house library for that, because that is available in a certified way. Mm-hmm. And then at one time, I heard a colleague talk about the amazing speed of Blaze. I think now Klaus is probably happy. And so I thought, oh, okay, it was a colleague from the optimization team. So I said, okay, I'll try it out. And I don't know, it cost me maybe a week of work or so to implement that. Getting to know a Blaze, it wasn't that difficult. And then you have to implement all of the operations. And when that's finished, you can just pull one switch, change it, and you have the other library.
Yeah, that's amazing, actually. So you get to choose the right library for you.
Yeah, you can also benchmark a little bit, see compile times or whatever, and runtime.
Yeah, excellent. I think there's some more questions. Is it somehow possible to distinguish torque unit, Newton x meter, from energy, also Newton times meter, in the physical unit checks?
Probably yes, because you could just use a different index type. So these index types are similar to quantity kinds. And I'm already representing X, Y, Z position, which has the same unit. So I think in this case, it's also possible and also fairly easy because I'm not transforming between coordinate frames. So if you would transform between coordinate frames, then this might be difficult, but for torque and energy, probably this wouldn't be transferred to a different coordinate frame, then it should be easy, I think. Unless I missed a part of the question.
I think so, I hope so. Maybe if the question didn't like fully made it or you didn't get the answer you were looking for, we will have an after talk chat in just a couple of minutes. We'll post the link in the chat and you can just join us and ask Daniel direct questions. So keep that in mind. So exactly, yeah, the link is already in the chat. Can someone please tell me what is the full name of the book or Hart? Maybe you could one time more.
Multidimensional analysis, algebra and systems for science and engineering, George W. Hart. Yeah, you can get it on the.
If you didn't catch it,
I think it's printed on demand.
We'll post a video on YouTube just in a couple of days, so so you can go look it back up, or maybe someone will write it in the chat right now. I think that's the last question. So with that, yeah, we're going to see you in a minute in the after talk chat.
Yes.
Thank you, Daniel, for your wonderful presentation.
See you soon. Bye.